So I'd like to start by thanking Jochen, of course, also Yuki and Chen for the organization of this nice event. I wasn't aware of this, so when it's amazing to look at the website. So it's an honor to join the other speakers. And thanks for the kind words on our joint activities and what we are trying to do for the community. So I've given a similar talk. This is my summary overview talk. So if some of you have been to other conferences where I've been speaking, most of the material will be the same because it's an overview. I did include some latest papers, and I will also include a slide on the future on what I want to do with the ERC and other general research. So let me start with this slide that really sets the scene on my, if you want, epistemological, philosophical, my motivation of doing science. What do I do and why I do this and how I do this? So two main aims in my research. One is more computer sciencey, in the sense I want to design robots, meaning design the software for robots. I don't work on hardware. How the scientific question is, how can we design the AI side of robotics, the software side of robotics, in particular by focusing on two main skills, which has been the main focus of my research in the last 10, 15 years. Language has been always my interest, in particular the grounding of language, and I'm going to give a long introduction on this. And then the second part, which is relatively more recent, is on trust and social robotics and human-robot interaction. So the first part, which I say is 80% of my work, 80% is just a random number, but it's a clear main focus, is on the robotics side and the cognitive robotics, computer science. The other bit of my work, let's say 20% or minority, is to still continue to be a psychologist, in the sense I wanted to understand how cognition works, primarily, but not necessarily in people, in particular in children, because we look at development, but even in psychology, studying artificial cognition, like robots or simulated agents, like I used to in the past, it's also a valid approach. So computer science is like a robot, can be considered like an animal model in psychology. So you study evolutionary aspects, you go to animal psychology. You study developmental, you go to children as a model, you know, an actual model of development, and we try to build robots that do the same. And you will see, at least in one main paper, we achieved the stage where our models are so constrained on what we know about psychology that they can make prediction on human behavior, on children behavior. So first part of the talk, the majority of my talk is on language, which is primarily what I do, language grounding. And I like to start with lots of philosophy and psychology background in the initial part. And so Quine is a philosopher of language and cognitive science, and he says, it's like a thought experiment. Let's pretend we go to the Amazon, we discover a new tribe which has had no contact with Western cultures. So we don't know their language, they do speak a language. And we hear the word gavagai when we and them, the local people, are looking at a scene like this. So if we could do an interactive talk and I asked you, what's the possible meaning of gavagai in the language of this new tribe, there isn't a single hypothesis. In fact, the whole point of Quine using this experiment is to say that language meaning is indeterminate. It's hard to determine it. Of course, it is possible with different approaches, but it's hard to determine in a single or easy case. This is the case. In fact, here, gavagai could be rabbit, could be girl, could be carrot. It could be something more abstract. It could be happiness. It could be one, because we are referring to one carrot. It could be two. You know, there is one, why don't you give two? So we don't really know the meaning of words. Now, this is not a philosophical experiment only. This is actually an experiment or an actual life experience that we all went through it. When we were learning language as babies, we heard words like rabbit in English, coniglio in Italian, gavagai doesn't exist. And we have to guess if the word coniglio, rabbit, was referring to the whole animal, to the eyes of the animals, the fluffy skin, or whatever you want. So there is no way to do this. But we still solve the problem. And how did we solve the problem? It's a combination of mechanisms. There isn't a single answer. There isn't a single mechanism. So for example, Linda Smith and colleagues have proposed the idea, it's also called cognitive bias, the bias of shape. So if we hear a new word, which we know it's a label, it's a name for the object, one of the main hypotheses is that the word must have to do with the big shape. So if you see only the shape of an animal, a rabbit, we attribute the word rabbit, the whole word rabbit, to the whole shape, the shape of the rabbit, not to the parts. And then there are the mechanisms you will see later, mutual exclusivity. If I know some of the words and the objects being labeled, then I hear a new word and I see a new object. By mutual exclusivity, I attribute the name, the new name, to the new object I see. So many mechanisms that we as children went through, and we are able to learn language in an efficient way. But then we go from philosophy to child psychology, but now let's go to robotics. What if I have to teach a robot to speak English and to be able to understand, to have a shared understanding of the meaning of words? So gavagai, rabbit, means the whole animal, not the part of the animal, and so on. So how do we do this? Now, I updated my slides. After GPT, you must update your slides. So there is there a ChatGPT logo, and I used to say computers can be pre-programmed to memorize a text. We don't need to pre-program them anymore. Computers can be trained, you know, with a hardcore machine learning approach to memorize text, to predict text in the case of this ChatGPT. But of course, computers have no understanding. The program itself has no understanding of the meaning of words it is using. Now, there are new models that try to link, let's say, embodiment to ChatGPT, but clearly ChatGPT itself doesn't do any grounding, which is the same of a 57-year-old chatbot, which is the very first one, called Eliza. Eliza, developed by MIT, Weizenbaum, could dialogue via text like ChatGPT with people, of course, much less complexity, but still no understanding. So how, but if I want to link, if I want to use a robot to give it meanings, grounded meanings, meaning related to the robot's visual and motor experience, how do I do this? One way to do this is to link ChatGPT or Eliza or any Alexa, any of these dialogue systems, with the robot, and ideally something will work. So let's give Pepper a link to ChatGPT or to a dictionary. And I ask Pepper, what's the meaning of push? Pepper is an API that talks to ChatGPT, and ChatGPT, or this isn't really ChatGPT, but if ChatGPT was trained on this Webster dictionary only, we'll give a definition like this. Push is defined as to press forcefully against to move, which is a good demonstration of an understanding, text-based. So I ask a question, I get an answer, which is to me meaningful, to me, human reader. Now I want to challenge the robot further. I say, give me the definition of force. But remember, Pepper can't really do too many complex things, but it can push something easily. Force, Pepper's robots have force sensors. So it should be a straightforward concept. But if I ask what's the meaning of force, because they rely on this dictionary type or training type system, it will tell me in my dictionary, in my memorization of these text predictions, force is defined as energy or strength, which is fine. It makes sense to us. But now let's look at the problems. You see the merry-go-round game appearing there, the horses game. If I go in depth, I will end up after two or three attempts into a vicious circle, words to words to words, which is what ChatGPT does, let's be honest, which is what a parrot does, right? Some parrots are very good at answering questions from people. In fact, Sivan Harn and other people called ChatGPT like a parrot, and I like this metaphor. It's a parrot. Do we think parrots understand words when they speak? I mean, there is some understanding there, but let's not too much in depth. What we want to communicate here, if you use words only, you are in a world-only world, which is not where robots live. Robots live in the real world. Now, a further demonstration, because I like the video on this philosophical experiment, thought experiment called the Chinese Room Experiment by John Searle. This comes from a documentary from a few years ago. David Eagleman, American neuroscientist, did a six-part documentary on the brain. The last document episode is on the artificial brain, AI. And at the time, he came to do some filming in Plymouth on my robot language learning experiments. But before showing the experiment, he actually showed this nice video telling us about the Chinese Room Experiment.
In the 1980s, the philosopher John Searle was chewing on this problem, and he came up with a thought experiment that gets right at the heart of it. And he called this the Chinese Room.
The experiment goes like this. I'm locked in a room. Outside, there's someone who only communicates in Chinese. She writes out some questions and then posts those to me in the room.
Now, I don't speak Chinese, but I do have these books and they give me instructions on exactly what to do with these symbols. So I look in the book and if I can find a match to the symbols, then the book tells me exactly how to respond. So I can look up this response. That matches. So now I can post this as the reply to the message I received.
When our Chinese speaker receives the message, it makes perfect sense to her.
您最喜欢哪一本书? 哪里是中国的首都? 你梦里梦到什么?
As far as she's concerned, we're having a conversation in her language.
So I like this sentence. As far as the Chinese speaking person understands, they are having a conversation. David understands what he's answering. It's like, as far as I'm understanding, I'm having a conversation with ChatGPT, who gives me the capital of China, and I'm sure I haven't tested it, but I will do it very well, probably. With some hallucinations, sometimes it might be a different city, but most of the time we expect it to work. But we know this is not the case, right? David is just doing picture matching, no meaning, no grounding. It's up, but it's still giving the impression this is happening. So I see that there are a few connectors. If you pay attention, please, I like to use the, just to make the talk a bit more interactive and alive. If you can use the chatbot, please, to answer my question in this different language. It's not Italian. Don't Google it, please. I can check if you're Googling, but don't Google it. I don't think you will get a reply. But I'm going to ask you now, the same way as the lady asked about the capital of China, I'm going to ask you in this language, quanti anni avi la picciotta? This is a question of a real language. And then please use, like David did, a matching mechanism where you get the question, which is here at the top, quanti anni avi la picciotta? Try to find in the reply rule book, David had a two-page, two-side book, right? Question on one side, answer on the other side. So can somebody please try to answer the question, quanti anni avi la picciotta? Use the reply rule book, matching of these characters. You need to do a bit of substitutions of X, Y, Z, A, B. And if you give me the wrong answer, this is actually good because the whole point is that, you know, this is a process that needs some practice. So can somebody please type the answer to my question, quanti anni avi la picciotta? Very good. La X avi e anni, very good. La picciotta avi e anni, excellent. You are building on each other in the sense you are doing in parallel. So try to change A into something else because X and A are variable. So in one hypothesis, la picciotta substitute X, which is nice. La picciotta avi 7 anni, excellent. Well done, Sophie. 12 years, that's possible. We said, you know, anything is right. Oh, in the matching, let's see what we are supposed to do. So, quanti anni la picciotta? There are three questions. The first one is the right one. That's easy. X stands for picciotta. So, let's go to the right side. La picciotta ave molti anni. That's also correct. Actually, molti anni is also correct. I mean, relatively speaking. So, la picciotta is the format of the answer. Avi, so most of you, all of you actually answer the same template. And then you need to substitute A with something else to make it a bit more interesting. So how do I find A? So let's look for anni. So let's, and picciotta, right? The words in the context. Let's try to be like a ChatGPT word context only. Let's look in the context of the dictionary. Word picciotta, there it is, the first one. And then the word anni, which is easy, is the second word. Before anni, I have another symbol, setti. That's why this is correct. Okay. It could be many other things. But what matters is that the correct answer is la picciotta avi 7 anni. So as far as I'm concerned, I'm speaking Sophie with Sophie. You gave the first correct answer. As far as I understand, we are having a conversation in my Sicilian dialect. And I'm in Sicily at the moment. That's how I speak to my parents. Okay. So for me, it's a real language. Sophie, I hope you don't know Sicilian. No, I hope. We assume you are not Sicilian. So you don't know what you're talking about, but we are having a conversation. I'm very pleased of this correct conversation. And all your other guys, you gave me, you know, correct answers. But how do we know how do we go beyond this? How do we give shared meanings? Having a conversation is to share the meaning. So one way to do this is to do what we call in the field grounding. We link our words into our sensory motor experience. Sensory motor is vision, is motor, but it's also internal states, happiness, sad state. The sad word has to do with internal grounding. So grounding is really general. So how do we do this? Remember Gavagai, the whole point of showing you Gavagai, because I can say Gavagai or Picciotta, right? Instead of saying Gavagai, because I'm speaking Sicilian, you say Picciotta. And if I ask you what's the meaning of Picciotta, most of you will say girl, some will say person, child, smiley, hair. It could be anything, mouth, because I need to show you in a Gavagai many examples of girl. In this case, girl is correct. More examples here are the words. Let's ignore zanzina, it's a bit more complicated. Chicken is easy, egg is easy, seeds, food, it's kind of more ambiguous, but it's easy. So we are grounding words into our experience. Now, what we do up to now, we call these concrete words, because the mapping between what I see, what I feel, what I do, if it's an action, it's actually straightforward. An egg can change color, can change slightly shape or size, but all eggs will be the same. Concrete words. Now, what's the meaning of picca? If I ask you to do something interactive, you would say, some would say three, it's number three. Others would say plural of eggs. So the word eggs is an exception, it's a different morphology. Others would say few, many, some, food, round shape. Everything is correct. Remember Gavagai, we don't know until we do more learning. This is called in psychology cross-situational learning, when you keep testing examples with different stimuli. So let's do cross-situational learning, and I'm going to show you this now. So what's the meaning of picca? Let's cut the number three as an hypothesis, because now picca also refers to two objects. So it's not number three. It could be plural. It could be the morphological ending in Sicilian to mean plural, right? Like the S in English. But now let's go further. Cross-situational learning, further cross-comparison. So now the insight should be more clear. Picca must mean few. Assai must mean many, right? Because it's the same things, but different quantities, whatever quantity means. So these are examples of abstract words like numbers or quantities, fuzzy quantifiers. When you say some could be two, three, but it could be 10. If you have a big crowd, some people in the crowd could be 10 people. Now, what's the meaning of manciare? It could be Mr. Bean, the Sicilian word for Mr. Bean. It could be man, it could be pizza, it could be eating, it could be teddy bear. But if I show you this, you know it must be about the action, right? It's, of course, it could be the emotion, it could be happy, angry, or eat in this specific way. Sicilian, eat, we say manciare. So this is an example I like to show, and I'm glad I'm doing this from Sicily for once. It really shows that important to us as babies, as robots, as artificial agents, what do we need to do to learn to speak? So robots need to do something similar. And rather than reinventing the wheel, why don't we go back to psychology, see what mechanisms children use, evolutionary as prepared, let's say, for us to solve the Gavagai problem. So there are, first we know that maybe starting with a brain that knows all the words might not be good, especially for us because we have to learn thousands of words. For bees, for vertebrate monkeys, because there are very few words to learn, maybe you can embed them in the genes, evolutionary speaking, but not for humans. Also, children don't go to school to learn to speak. They learn to speak in their physical world. You will see a video demonstration in a moment. The brain is very modular. We have vision, audio, motor processing in different parts of the brain, but many scientists, including Friedman, Pulver-Müller, have demonstrated that the motor area of the brain are also active during language processing. So there is a strong co-activation of modalities. And finally, we don't learn in an isolated world. We learn in a social world. I trust some teachers, my parents. I don't trust, you know, my peers when I'm a baby. I'm not sure they know the words. And you will see examples in the second part of my talk. Now, here I'm preaching to converted people. So this is you and me. We are this computer scientists, most of us, roboticists, some of us building the robots, linguists, psychologists, and I did some work on modeling animal language learning, for example, with the chimpanzees in Georgia at the time. I was only doing models. So I don't need to preach to you about this. I hope you know this book by now, with Matthew Schlesinger. And kindly enough, I had some advertisement from Jochen on the new book, but don't worry, I'm not trying to make money out of you because it's open access nowadays. So MIT Press, many publishers probably, offer you the possibility to do open access. So the link is there, all the chapters are available. And many of you, Yuki, you have a chapter. Of course, we thank Minora for doing the editing, and many of you have chapters in this. Of course, if you want to buy a nice hard copy, we don't stop you from doing this. Okay, so no more introduction. I think I've converted you on the importance of taking bio-inspired approaches from development in this specific case, because we are talking about language grounding and learning, which is what we do. And we are going to, in parallel, continue to switch between psychology experiments and baby experiments. Let's call this field embodied language learning, because we are focusing in particular on the embodied side, the active side of learning. And the way to do this is, because I've been a computer scientist for 26 years now in a computer science department, I don't pretend anymore I'm a psychologist. I joke, but it's not a joke, it's the truth. I canceled my membership of the Italian Professional Body for Psychology a long time ago. So now I'm a computer scientist. But to work with psychologists, I work with real baby lab experts. So Linda Smith is there. You will see Chen. We took experiment inspiration from some of Chen and Yu experiments. Colleagues in Plymouth, in Manchester, and also I'm working a lot with colleagues in Cattolica University in Milan, Marchetti for Theory of Mind. So this picture at the bottom represents the simplified time scale of development in the first 3 years, phonetic year one, perceptual and vocabulary growth in year two, language production, and then a bit of syntax and grammar in year three. And we want to model with the examples that you see there of these experiments. So let's see how we did this now 10 years ago. So we read a paper, we contacted Linda Smith to try to model their experiment. Let's watch the video on this experiment.
Look at that. Want to play with that?
This video wants to show that children use their posture, left and right body movement,
thank you,
their attention to objects, and to learn their words, the names, even when the objects are not visible when they are named.
Thank you. Look at this. Look. Oh, look what I have. Look at that. You want to play with that? It's a Modi. Oh, it's
so
a Modi.
So finally, the researcher names the object only once, then the object is not visible.
What's in here? Oh, look at that. You want to play with that?
So this is the end of the experiment, the test for the children, 18 to 24 months, early stages of typically one-word learning. You mix them. At the beginning, the researcher only named the object once. Look at the Modi. The object wasn't actually visible, but the object was clearly in the left part of the space where the body posture was being used by the child. This is the summary of the experiments. Left, right, hide the object in step five. Say the object name when the child is looking at the right part, at the left, our left part of the screen, and then mix them and see what happens. 73% means in psychology and statistics, the majority of children systematically learn the association. Instead, if you change the location, plus you do other manipulations, you see that there is no consistency, no random choice, chance behavior. So this shows, together with other experiments, that posture is important to learn the name of the objects without seeing the object. When you hear the name and you learn and you see the object, this is called fast mapping. I have the two modalities at the same time and I learn, say, fast. So 10 years ago, we had our new ICAP in Plymouth. So let's say, well, let's teach it to speak. We had a project called iTalk, which was about speaking. So we did some experiments. This is, again, a classical video from...
So this is the ICAP robot, and today we're going to teach it the names of some objects. Up here, a truck and a ball. So let's see how we go.
So this is path mapping now.
Ball.
Ball.
Truck.
Truck.
So path mapping, two words.
Ball.
When you test it, the robot understands the word by looking at it. It's not ChatGPT, chat only. It's behavior that counts here. Demonstration, attention, selection from the many objects and so on.
Science truck.
Science truck.
In the next video, you will see the second part of the experiment where the object is hidden when we name it.
So when children learn the names of objects, those objects don't have to be in sight. It can be through association. So we'll show you how that works on the robot. Can you show an object?
So pay attention to the robot head and posture in the next frame. Robot head.
Then we can hide the object. Say, piano.
Piano.
Find piano.
So what happened here is that the robot was looking at the piano. Then when Tony moved the piano away towards, let's say, his left, the robot turned towards the object. And then Tony had to shake the hands to get the attention back to the same posture. It's all about body posture, where you show the object with respect to the body posture association. And here are the experiments. The first three sets of experiments, the first five experiments, are robot data simulating what we knew was happening in children. In the last two columns, it's the other way around. We predicted by running additional robot experiments that in one situation, experiment 5 and 9, there would have been a correct association of the word versus another condition, interference task. Interference task is when you keep moving the objects in the wrong location. If you keep moving the object, in addition, you move more dimensions of your body posture. From left, right, you also add up and down. So if you enrich the motor behavior and you enrich the complexity of the task, the interference task, you can still get the robot to learn. This was our prediction from robot data. And a few months after, in Indiana, they collected the data to show this was the case. Remember my first slide, 80% I want to build robot AI software, 20% I like to understand better, find mechanisms that allow children to learn. Most of us, I guess, are computer scientists, AI people. So where is the AI here? We have neural networks. A few years ago, we didn't have deep learning widely used. So we used cone maps to represent categorical similarity of colors or shapes. Body posture is represented as a winner-take-all map into a cone map, self-organizing map. And then the dotted lines here are unsupervised Hebbian associative learning, which is what happens when you hear the word associations. You associate between modalities, vision typically, and speech, but it could be motion if you have an action label. More recently, this is a paper from 2022, I think. This is work by Chen Yu that he did when he was in Indiana. I love this video because it shows a very different way of describing, understanding what happens in language learning. We are used to the image on the right, which is what you saw in some way in the video that I presented earlier. We see the learner, the child or the robot. In front of us, we see the object. We think of us moving objects and the robot almost passively, or the child looking at the object. Instead, look at the screen on the left here, with the camera in the front of the child, which is, let's say, near the children's eyes here. As you can see, it's a very, very active process. In addition, either the parents move the object towards their face, which means in my eyes, a big part of my pixels, let's say, on my vision space will be used by the object itself. So it's not that I'm looking at three objects. In some cases, I'm looking at one object. That's why the association is easier and stronger. Either child moving the object closer to their eyes, or the parents doing it. And we did some experiments with Luca Raggioli, my PhD student, to model the same mechanism with the same architecture from before. We added some time incremental mechanisms. So the same video as before. We train the model to learn objects with different strategies. Passive one.
This is a bottle.
Meaning I see one object in the middle, but many objects possible.
This is a cell phone.
And now a more active way. This is the parent giving the...
This is a cup.
Showing the cup to the child. You can see the input is very different, visually speaking. So no surprise that the child, or the robot in this case, become more efficient when learning about this object.
Hello, I'm Pepper. What object do you want me to look at?
The cup.
Okay.
And then this here, you just test that the robot understands the meaning of words by looking at the reference. Okay, so some earlier work where you add time here. How do you teach the robot the meaning of a word, of a set of words?
Slide left,
like
the
two
ball.
Or three words, object name and label for the action. Data collection for model training. Now you see the robot doing the testing after you do this offline training. Or it's one of the early
slide right,
Bintani,
the
MPRNN,
ball.
Recurrent neural network. And then you see in the bottom, you add
slide
modalities
left,
from action learning
cup.
Only, the top video.
Slide left,
you have two modalities.
The
and now let's put things together, because in our field, I'm preaching to converted, I guess, we have this dream of open-ended cumulative learning. So let's send our child to this virtual in the garden.
Hello. This is a box.
Of fast mapping.
What is this?
Bugs.
Where is the box?
Now we see the mechanism of mutual exclusivity.
Where is the stapler?
No box, by exclusivity, stapler must be the other.
Where is the box?
Now another mechanism, word order and two-word learning. So two
red.
Words for each red. Object. Now language generalization.
What is this?
The robot red. Only knows the name for the shape, here for the color, of course.
What is this?
And then
red.
We have a video that goes longer for that examples. I think this is a nice summary of how all these mechanisms, which we said at the beginning, are called cognitive biases in category and language learning in developmental psychology, can be combined together to have an open-ended cumulative learning type approach, which is what we want to show works in the field. Now, remember my Sicilian example, easy words, egg, chicken, picciotta, uovo, ovo. Now let's look at the abstract words, which are the tricky ones here. So how do we model abstract words? Because, for example, if I want to show the concept of one, I can show one piano, one ball, one car, one leaf, one stapler, they all look different. How do I represent the concept of one? The answer is embodiment, right? That's how we learn to count. Before we actually deal about real quantities, we play the game of counting our fingers or performing. There is something in neuropsychology showed that we have a mental line where small quantities are on the left for people, cultures like Western culture that read left to right. Of course, if you swap the reading direction, the mental line will be swapped. But what matters here is that unintuitively, almost, body, embodiment is important for abstract concept. The more abstract the concept is, the more important it is. So an example here on finger counting.
2 plus 2.
So we've done experiments. I don't need to show the results here because I want to show you something on the social element, but you see robot using finger counting. Here, robot, this is more recent, using CNN, deep learning for more complex images, using gestures in counting, because as you see in the chart on the left, Alibali Di Russo showed that if a child observes somebody or even a puppet pointing at objects being counted, or if the child counts herself, or if the child, even in more in other experiments, touches the object being counted, they learn much faster. And we show the same with our robots here. Now, this is what I promised I would do. What is my ERC project on? I titled it eTalk, for embodied thought for abstract language knowledge. It's basically modeling more complex aspects of language learning. So we use a set of different platform, all these interdisciplinary psychology, brain inspiration experiments, and then we have applications in tutoring for schools or older people. And we have three sets of abstract words. We can really model abstract words. Plus we say from the literature, abstract words are not binary. You know, it's concrete abstract. It's a continuum, okay? So we focus on abstractions from category level. So you have an apple, basic label, which is a pink apple, a specific type of apple that I might like, or higher level, you have more general labels like fruit. An apple is a fruit. Or higher level further, it's actually edible thing. So abstraction in categorizations, abstractions in numbers, more complex experiments of what I already did, and then function words like in and on, here, there, and you can go towards time function words like now and then. So from here and there, physical description to a temporal description, which is again harder to represent mentally. This is a project which will start probably in the new year. You are probably aware I'm based in the UK. We still haven't agreed with the Europeans and the British what to do. So the project will be funded by UKRI now. We have British money for this ERC project. And finally, I promised that I would look at social aspects of learning. Remember, bio-inspiration, children learn as low, use their body. Neuroscience shows the cross-modality activation, and now theory of mind. When we learn, we learn because we attribute mental states, intentions, goals to other people. Again, back to psychology, if I ask you, this is a real experiment, which object is the lady going to choose? We can guess from this body shape and hand shape that the object is the large one because of the aperture of the hand. And taking inspiration from this, with Samuel and Minanzi and Christian Gehrig from Honda, we did some experiments on goal, intention reading for goals using some clustering algorithms, and the input is motor information.
Show me the rules of the game. I will learn them so that we can play together.
So the robot extracts skeletons from...
What goal did you just show me?
Ball.
Do you want to show me another goal?
Yes.
Okay then, let's continue.
Open pose, for example, can be used to extract from an OMAD camera skeleton.
Tower.
Four examples of goals, different behavioral sequences, practically. Clustering of postures, sequence learning. And now, test. Playing is the test.
We are building a tower.
The robot is reading the intention, the goal of the lady, and it's indicating which object comes next. More, this is one component of social interaction, intention reading, but if you put more complex representations of social skills, we call this theory of mind. So theory of mind is knowing that other people, other agents have goals, like in the previous example, have individual preferences, have intentions, have desires, have emotions. And how do you study theory of mind in children? Because it developed over the early years. They used to run a Sally Ann of false belief test. It's a cartoon. The child sees two characters, Sally and Ann, two boxes, one toy, second frame. Sally hides the object in the first location. She goes away. Naughty Anne swaps the object. Then in the final frame, you ask the children, where will Sally look for her toy? Earlier in development, 3-4 years of age, children say the object will be in the box on our right because that's where they see it. It's a bit like the A, not B situation here. Instead, early in development, you start to attribute mental states. So Anne moved the object. Sally doesn't know that Anne moved the object because she was aware. So for Sally, the object must be in the location where she, this is how you measure this. And then this work was extended to, because I'm studying language, to language learning, you can have a good teacher, a bad teacher, and you have a theory of mind of the teachers. So let's add now theory of mind models using a Bayesian algorithm to the previous language learning experiment. This is the basic Blue. Fast mapping.
Cup.
We have this. First
okay.
Teacher is the parent.
This is the cup. Say.
Ground truth, my parent. What my parent teaches me.
This is a dog.
Second teacher.
In my opinion,
I compare
this
with
is
my
a cup.
Ground knowledge, ground truth, my parents' truth. Then.
This is a cup.
So the robot is
yes,
creating
is a
different theory of mind representation for the different teachers.
This is a Loma.
So new object,
okay.
I need to learn a new name. Which name do I choose if I'm giving alternatives?
This is a duck.
Okay.
Now let's test what the robot learned with the parent, the ground truth, let's say.
What is this?
I think this
okay,
is
you can
a
see
text.
That we can map theory of mind representation to language learning. And second experiment is on simulating the same task of the false belief here in this experiment conducted in San Diego by Vanderbilt. They use stickers on a table. So a more embodied representation of the false belief task. It's not a cartoon. It's an interaction in a table and stickers being hidden.
Hello,
informer
number 0.
Please look at me. Can you suggest me the location of the sticker? Right.
Left.
So the trigger label is for us. The robot implicitly
right.
Learns a theory of mind of the untapped
market. Hello, informer number 1.
Left.
The reliable person. This Bayesian network integrating
right.
My perception as a robot and the person's perception and...
Hello again, informer 0.
Right.
I'm thinking at where to look based on your suggestion. I was right not to trust you.
No?
I've never seen you before. I'll call you informer 2.
Left.
I didn't trust you, but I was wrong. Sorry. Hello again, informer 1. I know the sticker is on the left. I also believe you would point left to me.
Okay, the last part we call this explainable AI. So once you build a theory of mind of different people, it would be good to be able to ask the robot, why are you making... You know, what's the basic of your reasoning? And then the robot will explain the prediction and so on. Then a final set of two final slides before the conclusions, which is modeling not only robots' theory of mind of people, but also people's theory of mind of robots. And you can show, before the experiment, you can show people a video of this.
Hello, Pepper. I'm Sam.
And I'm Anne.
Nice to meet you.
Okay. I'm just going to put this cube under my green cup.
Okay.
Okay. I've just got to pop out.
So it's
I'll
the Sally Anne experiment.
See you.
Acted
see
as
you.
A lady sadly going away.
Now that she's gone, I'm going to get the cube from her cup and I'm going to move it under my cup.
Okay.
Where do you think she will look for the cube when she's back?
Wait, let me think. Well, the cube is under the blue cup, so she is going to search there.
So you can see this is a an example where there is a failing of the false belief task, and then you run an you show participants this video, and then you run an experiment where they are buying objects from a robot, and the amount of money that the person spends is an indication how much I trust the robot. And you can see only the case where the robot sees the video, the person sees a video of a robot who understands about theory of mind representations, you spend more, which we call this a measure of trust. So trust depends on theory of mind. If I have a high concept of your mental capabilities as a robot, as as a user, then I'm going to trust the robot more. This has been linked also to other studies looking at the role of gaze. The more if the robot looks at you when it's interacting with you in this trust game, then you are going to spend more money with the robot just because of the social skills. And to conclude, we are doing experiments with children, HRI experiment with children, looking at the aspects of the trust. So here again, you see a simulation in a real setup of the Sally Ann object hiding task. Now, let me conclude by summarizing what I think are the pros, what we have achieved, and then what are the future challenges in which we are focusing. So what's positive, I think, about the approach we've been following? First, I think I don't know your backgrounds. Hopefully there will be people from different backgrounds, but the importance of working together and letting experts be experts in the field. So I could pretend I'm a psychologist, right? Because I have a degree in psychology. I haven't really practiced proper experimental psychology methods personally. That's why we collaborate with psychology. So it is good to respect each other's skills and work together in some way. Embodiment, I think, with a number of examples and other, the language learning, posture, manipulation, there is no doubt that embodiment is important, including in abstract word learning, where you would say an abstract word is a word which has less of a link to perceptual representation or to motor representation, but then you still need embodiment to learn this abstract concept. You looked at the example between social aspects of theory of mind and the link to trust, the two coins of trust, robots' trust of people and people's trust of robots. And if there are any experimentalists, you can see that if we set up our experiment in a well-confined way, we can sometimes model real experimental setup and therefore be able to make some predictions. What are we doing next? So open-ended learning, larger lexicons, including the focus now on more complex abstract word categories. Explainable AI and trustworthy robots is a very big challenge. We have many projects in the UK, in Europe at the moment on trustworthy AI. And I didn't really look at the application side, but what we are doing matters not only for science, but also ideally to build more complex and capable robots, which one day will support when we are getting older and children in tutoring scenarios and so on. And I think I can stop here. Thank you.